Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. I'm so glad. Apostle Paul's letter to the Roman church, Romans chapter 12, verse 2. The Good News Translation says, "Do not conform yourselves to the standards of this world, but let God transform you inwardly by a complete change of your mind. Then you will be able to know the will of God, what is good and is pleasing to Him and is perfect." Amen. You may be seated in God's house. Amen. Always so good to have in the household of faith with us, Reverend Dr. Marvin McNichol. Thanks for praying. It's always so wonderful to have you here working with us. And I'd like to tag this particular text and message for these brief moments of sharing that we have together this morning with the title, A Changed Change Agent. A Changed Change Agent. Thomas Kelly suggested that the human mind should be used for processing and not storage. The implication is that your mind should be a place for fluidity of thought, not for stagnation and inactivity. Your mind should always be in a state of activity. It should be relatively free. Your mind should be free to believe, to develop, to envision, to expect, to decide, to project, to enhance, to wonder, to suggest, to infer, to think, to rest, and to dream. Your mind should be free to consider your awesome possibility and to have faith in the God that does all things well, who has subdued all things. Your mind ought to be. It ought to be free to believe that nothing is impossible with God. Free to think that your God is able to supply all of your needs. It ought to be free to study and understand God's plan for your life. It ought to be free to believe in every child you meet. It ought to be free to believe in your propensity for success. It ought to be free for you to consider the error in your own ways. Free to embrace new challenges, to go to new heights, and to live with renewed energy. Your mind ought to be free. Most importantly, it ought to be free enough to think of the goodness of Jesus and all that He's done for you. It ought to be free to remember that God has brought you from a mighty long way, that He's brought Antioch, He's brought you, He's brought us from a mighty long way. It ought to be free enough to remember that God kept you when you could not keep yourself. You know, He held you when you wanted to let go. He protected you when you were your most vulnerable. He lifted you when you were down. He loved you when you didn't even like yourself. The fact is that your mind ought to be free. Many of us, however, don't operate with free minds. Some of you in here right now, this morning, this day, some of you cannot worship, you cannot praise, you cannot connect with the Word of God, the music, the prayers, because you're worried about something right now. You didn't tell nobody that. You didn't say anything to anybody, but you came to church. You dragged yourself to church, and you're so consumed by worry that you cannot give God what belongs to Him. Your mind is somewhere else, thinking about something or somebody else. And sadly, there's now some new stuff that we got to worry about, that you didn't know you had to worry about before. Now you got to worry about if some clown who's been emboldened by their president is going to curse at you or spit at you or call the police on you for selling lemonade or for going to your pool or driving your own car or passing out literature for your church or for a candidate. You got to be worried about all of these things going on in the world. You got to be worried about whether or not your president is a pawn of the Russian government. You got to be worried about all of these things now that we didn't know we had to worry about. We got enough to worry about just being black and brown in America. Now we got to worry about all this other stuff. Our minds are often controlled justifiably sometimes by worry and doubt. And if you did an inventory, though, of the focus of your worry, you will discover that much of what you worry about is stuff that you and I cannot control. Our minds are clouded with thoughts of indifference and insolence. Sometimes it's blurred with thoughts of bling and popularity. Our minds are blocked by selfishness and silliness. And the only way to move from ordinary and mundane and drab discipleship to becoming a change agent, a world-changing, standard-raising disciple, is you first gotta change your mind. The Bible says that change, being a change agent, begins and ends in the mind. That's why it declares that you got to let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. It's telling you to change your mind. You're not feeling that way yet. So let me try it like this. Every once in a while, my car has to go to the shop and get an oil change. I did some research on what they're actually doing when they change my oil. They changed my oil so I could be conversing in the language of oil changery, and they couldn't get over on me when I take my car in to get the oil change. I learned that when they do an oil change, they take out the old oil, which often gets dirty from wear and tear. It gets dirty from the car having to stop and start. It gets dirty from the engine machinations. And so every 3 months or so, every 3,000 or 5,000 miles, I got to take it to get the oil change. And what they do is they flush out the old dirty oil tainted by the conditions under which you've been driving, and they replace it with fresh oil. And every now and then, you and I need to change our minds like that. You need to flush out worry and doubt, flush out anger and bitterness, flush out hatred and unforgiveness, flush out silliness and self-deprecation, flush out fear, flush out fronting and faking, and you got to replace it with love that lifts you, with love that leads you, love that empowers, love that protects, love that builds, love that confronts. Every now and then, you need to tell God to flush it out. You need a mind oil change. If you want your mind flushed every once in a while, if you want to be free to let your mind do what God called it to do, then you've got to take your mind to the Words Fix It shop. What are you talking about, Davidson? If your mind is going to change, if you're going to get a tune up, if it's going to be flushed out, then you need to take your mind to a place called the Word of God. You better flush it with the word that says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. A word that says he did not come to condemn the world, but he came to save my life. The word that says he rewards those who diligently seek him. The word that says you're more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ. The word that says God is my refuge and my strength. And I can't speak for you, but I declare that I don't want to just be an ordinary, average, and standard follower of God, but I want to be a change agent that God can use to transform his world. That's how Antioch has survived 125 years, because there have been some change agents over the period of time that didn't see themselves as simply mundane believers, but they believed in the calling that God had given to the church to go and make disciples of men and women and children all over the world. And since I want to be used by God to change the world one person at a time, then I got to learn to let God flush out my mind. In this Pauline letter written to the Roman church, Paul is encouraging the members of this Christian church in Rome to flush out their minds so that they can be transformed change agents. Paul had not yet had the chance to visit the Roman institutional or missionary Missionary Baptist Church, but was writing in hopes of one day connecting with his brothers and sisters in Rome. This church had folks who were among the original converts on the day of Pentecost, but guess what? It also had people who had showed up last week saying, I want to be a follower of Jesus. The church was not a perfect church. It was not insulated or isolated from self-doubt or worry or sexual indiscretion or indecision, fighting between the cultures in the church, political turmoil, upheaval between the rich and the poor. They are in the middle of all of that mess. They had no pastor. Preachers would come in and out. They were self-sustaining, but they were in the middle of a Roman culture that believed in polytheism, in the gods of the sun, the moon, the stars, love, war, time, flowers, and money. And they were threatened by this new group of Christian converts. And so they had all of that going on around the church. They were divided by socioeconomic status in the church. The rich were well educated in private institutions, while the poor had to learn to read and write on their own. Power was determined by your money, and the divide between the power and the privilege was wide. Some folks have trouble being a change agent because we don't know what it is that we have at our disposal. Let me unpack that. In Pastor Paul, this articulate African apostle, he writes this missive not while he's sequestered in some penthouse villa in Madagascar on the ocean chilling, but he writes it from the dusty dark roads of Corinth, where he's traveling against his better judgment, traveling under the threat of persecution and unjust prosecution into territories that are kind trying to keep God's word out of those areas. So here he is, and the sad truth today is that there are people in God's house who try to keep God's word out of the activities in his own house. Help me, Holy Ghost. And anytime you can overcome your dark moments to give a moving missive with a motivational message to the masses, I would consider you a change agent. Oh, this great gospel globetrotter, Paul, is telling them that even from the dark, dusty road, you are called to love the hell out of every heart and the hate out of every village. But he knows that if they're going to do it, then they need to aspire to be change agents. A change agent really is simply a dynamic disciple. You can't be a wounded healer, somebody with your own brokenness who's a blessing to somebody else with just ordinary discipleship. You can't help somebody when you're hurting. You can't love your enemies. You can't pray for them that spitefully use you. You can't tell somebody I love you who's been cussing you out. You can't do that unless your life has been changed by God. You do understand
that there are camp forces that operate to keep us just beneath our destiny and make us live life on the underside of average. We need change agents in the church and in the world. See, there are camp media forces and journalistic forces that are always trying to shape and redefine who we are. Even our entertainers, in some cases, have succumbed to the idea of changing your name. Instead of queen and princess, instead of king and prince, we are calling ourselves thugs and gangsters, and renaming is a part of imperial ideology and imperial methodology. An African evangelist who's a leader in Western Africa as a part of Child Evangelism Fellowship, he told me that the real issue with slavery was that they changed our names. That's why we can't trace many of our lineages to our ancestors, because of the name change. Names denoted your group, your family, your region, and so an imperial strategy to divide always starts by changing your name. In the empire of oppressors, you are what the empire says you are. When the oppressor conquers you, you are no longer Hadassah, but you are renamed Esther. You are no longer Azariah, Hananiah, Mishael. You are renamed Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. When your mind is changed about who you are no longer Seminole, or Apache, or Creek, or Choctaw, Comanche, Cheyenne, Navajo, Hopi, or Arawak, Pequot, or Arapaho. You're no longer Fenik or Akan, Ashanti, Fulani, Igbo, Yoruba, Ibio, or Zulu. You are renamed Minority. You are no longer just John, Jake, or Jane. You are renamed Majority, because in an imperial system, somebody got to be on top and somebody got to be on the bottom. And there's little upward mobility for those who are named Valley Dwellers. The scripture, though, declares that despite the labels that are misplaced on some of us, regardless of our color or our creed, it is your duty to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. It's your duty, black or white, Asian or Australian, to be a change agent. There is power that is greater than any and all of the oppressive forces that we face. There is a power that's greater than our finitude, that's greater than our issues. There's a power that's greater than who we are and what we think we can be. That power belongs to our all-powerful God. That's why our ancestors could sing over my head. I hear music in the air. There wasn't no music playing up there, but over my head, I see trouble in the air. There must be a God. Somewhere. And the real talk today is that these are no ordinary issues. These are no mundane problems. And you can't deal with extraordinary problems with ordinary tools. We're dealing with some extraordinary stuff, some strong and violent currents of racism in our politics and in the halls of justice, masked as a simple difference of opinion. We're dealing with sexual promiscuity, dealing with issues of identity and esteem, deadbeat mothers and fathers, broken homes and broken dreams and broken lives and families. We're dealing with the new Jim Crow, according to Michelle Alexander, the process of incarcerating black men at an alarming rate. And we need folks who've been changed. The people of God, those of us who are the church, can offer what nobody else can offer. That's what the church does. Nonprofit organizations can build houses. Nonprofits can combat addiction. They can address poverty and domestic violence. They can fight earnestly for civil liberties and childhood literacy, equal pay, and equal rights. But the church offers an added layer. Thank you. The Church of Jesus can change your heart. Thank you. And one heart change. Yes. One heart change can save a life. Yes. Think about it. If that young man or young woman thinking about pulling the trigger on themselves or somebody else, if they can have their heart changed, then two lives have been saved. At least two lives have been saved. We do not simply exist, church, as a covenant community to simply do prolific programming, but we are transformed to help change people's hearts. You do know that you don't come to church. You do know that, don't you? You don't come to church. You come to God's house to worship and fellowship with your brothers and your sisters, but you leave here to be the church. If we left this building, guess what? If we left this corner, if some future group 125 years from now decided to leave this neighborhood, this building would just be a building. It would be a restaurant or a grocery store or a museum. But what makes it God's house is that you bring God with you when you show up. If you are not the church, then this will cease to be a holy place. I'm in the book, John, in the Patmos prison said, and I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and will be their God. I parked there too long. The question I hear you asking is how do I become a change agent? I hear there's one answer and a promise. I promise you, and I'll be through. If you want to be a change agent, then the first thing you got to do is you got to reprogram your database. You got to reprogram your database. The text says, be ye transformed. I like that word, transform. In the text, it means to change, to alter, to reconfigure, to reshape, to redirect, transform. The letter is telling you that if you want to change, if you want to transform your circumstance and transform your relationships, then you have to be transformed first. If I could Davidsonize the text, I would just tell you that you got to reprogram your database. Most of us have a mental hard drive that is full of junk that needs to be reprogrammed. This same tactical theologian, Paul, helps us through his letter to the Galatian church when he tells them that a sign that you reprogram your database is that you only think to boast about the cross of Jesus Christ. That's crazy talk, Pastor Paul. Paul is out of his mind. Why would I boast about the cross of Jesus the Christ? I get excited, he's telling you, about the cross. That requires reprogramming. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. And when I renew it, I need to let my mindset be the mind that was also in Jesus Christ. And my Bible tells me that Jesus' mind was focused on crosstalk. And the truth is that if you knew more about the cross of Christ, if you understood the impact of the cross, then these pews wouldn't be able to hold your praise. But all of us have been inundated with an American Western Christianity which emphasizes prosperity over the cross. Well, And guess what? That's not new. In 1831, Alexander de Tocqueville, he said that in America, he hears a Christianity that's more interested not in how your soul does in the afterlife, but he said in 1831, almost 200 years ago, he said, it seems like they're more interested in what it can do for the individual to help them become more wealthy, more prosperous. But we're called to do crosstalk. Our database currently is structured to focus on getting something from God. We come to church to get something. Get something. We come. Get some turkey. Give me. That's why people connect with prosperity so quickly, because prosperity says, I'm getting something. Right. Wow. And the cross is, I got to give something up. That's American Christianity that says, now get something. And the Lord is always saying that if you want to get something, you got to give it away. That's the paradoxical principle of the Prince of Peace. If you want to go up, first fall down. You want to wear a crown, you got to bear the cross. You want to have favor, then you got to give something up. You got to be reprogrammed to know that you got to give some stuff up in order to be a change agent for God. The problem is we don't want to reprogram because we don't want to give anything up. When you're confronted with the cross of Jesus, you learn that you ain't all that. It's bad English, but it's good theology. When you're confronted with the cross of Christ in light of the cross, I got to realize I ain't all that. Amen. When I survey the wondrous cross, I realize I ain't all that, because it should have been me hanging from that tree. That should have been me up there. But I got to, the Lord is saying, you got to give it away. You got to be reprogrammed and know that you got to give some stuff up in order to be a change agent. The problem, you don't want to give anything up. But when you're confronted with the cross, you learn that there's some stuff in your life that's got to be reprogrammed. And the difficulty we have is that the cross and crosstalk doesn't make sense to us. And that's why we sometimes stay programmed the way we've always been programmed. Keep telling you, looking at me funny. You've been taught, if somebody insults you, I gotta insult you back. If you dog me out, if you hurt my feelings, I want payback, and I want it now. But and I'm gonna hold a grudge until the day I die. You gonna roll me down this aisle with a grudge. And pastor better not preach nothing about that grudge I've been holding. He better get me into heaven through this sermon that he's going to deliver at my funeral. But I got the grudge. I went to the grave with the grudge. I'm holding it. Because that's not cross talk. You, the cross says, pray for them that curse you. Do good to them that spitefully use you. Love your enemies. That's crazy talk, but that's cross talk. You're going through a major dilemma, some major trauma. You've been programmed to call all your people, even the ones that don't know anything about God. You call, you have a problem with your marriage, you call your single friends. They don't know nothing about marriage. They're biased also because they're your friends, so they're going to see things from your perspective. You call your sisters, your brothers, and you tell them all your drama, all your business. You do all of that, and you talk about it, and they can't do anything for you. And now you stuck like Chuck. But crosstalk says, take your burdens to the Lord. And then does it say, bring them back with you? It says, take your burdens to the Lord and... See, crosstalk is sometimes crazy talk. It don't make sense. It's illogical. It's called crosstalk. We need more crosstalk. When you reprogram, you start living by crosstalk. You in debt up to your eyeballs and over your head. You talk to your accountant, and they say, you got to pay this bill, pay that bill. And you say, I'm a believer, and what about my church? Some of y'all say that. They say ain't no money to give God's house. But crosstalk says if you're in debt, won't you bring God what belongs to God? And God will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you don't have room, but that's the call. That's what the book says. You got to reprogram your database. And in order to reprogram, you got to take some stuff out to get some stuff in. You got to give some stuff up. I got this thing. I shared it with you before. I got this thing called DVR. at the house, and the programs and the DVR have changed over time. I told you, some of the programs have changed, and there are some shows I like to look at. So I got the DVR set to record. It records Blackish. I got the Goldbergs in there. I got the Middle. The Middle going off. I used to have Scandal before that. That went off that way. How to Get Away with Murder, Black Lightning, Modern Family. I even keep Matlock in there. And I told you before, I always keep coming to America. Always, always keep coming. Don't judge me. I always keep coming to America in the holster, in the first three of the Indiana Jones movies and all of the Lethal Weapons, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Always in the DVR. But one day I go in and I'm getting ready to watch Matlock. But one of the episodes I didn't catch, even though I saw it 20 years ago, I don't remember what happened. I trained my brain to not remember so I can keep watching it over and over again. I go in and I click the DVR button to get to my shows, and in there, I see Black Girls Rock. I see Beyonce Lemonade. Fixer Upper. I see Casey Undercover. I see Shrek 1, 2, and 3, Raven's Home, Flip or Flop. I say, wait a minute! I didn't program none of that. I didn't put that in my program, and I'm looking for my shows, and the DVR says, database full. Oh, I'm hot now. Then I push the middle button, select, and it took me to my options, and it says, full, erase some of the programs. And I looked at it and I said to myself, in order to get my programs back in, I gotta get these programs out. So I started to go down the line. Beyonce, erase. Shrek, erase. Fixer Upper, erase. X Factor, whatever it was, erase, so I could make sure Coming to America was still in there. If you want to be a change agent, now, then in your database, you gotta learn how to reprogram it by taking some stuff out so you can put God's stuff in. Because the more you put in your database, the better you'll be able to handle this world. Won't you take out some of that junk that you got in your heart and in your mind and in your will and get it out? Take out those negative thoughts. Take out that negative attitude. Take out that cold demeanor and let me put some Philippians 4:13 in there. Let me put some Romans 10:9 that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart, you shall be saved. Let me put some John 3:16 in there. Let me put some Romans 8:37 in there. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through Jesus. You want me? Let me put Psalm 23 in there. If you don't know them, then go to the book and tell God, put them in there. Negativity. Erase, impatience erase, selfishness erase, self-doubt erase, self-hate erase, and tell God to drop some new stuff in your database. Gotta reprogram my database. Make sure you got a recording in there called Love Unconditional. Peace insurmountable, joy unspeakable, hope invisible, favor indivisible, power supernatural, salvation everlasting, grace incomprehensible. Make sure you got some stuff in there called justified, sanctified, beautified, and edified. If you're going to be changed so you can help the world change, you got to reprogram your database. And if you reprogram your database, this is the conclusive point. This is the celebration. This is the promise of the text. If you reprogram your database, then I promise you, you will be ready to deliver for God. You'll be ready to deliver for God. Once your database is reprogrammed, then you're ready to fulfill God's mandate to be a change agent in the world. Delivering for God simply means that you're living a life that reflects the love and light of God in and through your life. You're ready to deliver for God when you realize that your greatest performance is your next performance. You have not done the best that you can do. Y'all ain't feeling that yet. Let me try it like this. Well, Denzel Washington was interviewed by Ed Gordon at one of the award shows. I don't remember which one. Ed Gordon asked him what his favorite role was. And I thought when Ed Gordon asked him, I thought maybe he would say Training Day because he played a corrupt cop and won an Oscar for Training Day. I thought maybe Denzel would say Malcolm X when we learned that we had been hoodwinked, bamboozled, led astray, and run amok. And when he was able to hold those fingers up, he just pointed like this, and the brothers turned and started marching in succession. I thought maybe he was going to say Glory or Philadelphia, maybe remember the Titans or the Hurricane. But Denzel looked at Ed Gordon and he said, it ain't none of those. He looked at Ed Gordon and said, my best movie is my next movie. You ready to deliver for God when you realize that yesterday is nothing compared to what God is going to do for you tomorrow? I interviewed God and I asked God, what was your greatest performance? I asked God, what's your greatest performance in the beginning when you created cosmos out of chaos? God said, that was cool, Todd, but it wasn't my best performance. I asked God, well, was it when you took dust and made man, made human beings? God said, yeah, I remember that, but wasn't my best performance. I asked God again, what was it when you parted the Red Sea or the Sea of Reeds and folks walked across on dry ground? He said, cool, but not my best performance. Okay, God, I know I got you now. Maybe it was when Jesus died and 3 days later you raised him from the grave. That saved the world, son, but it wasn't my best performance. I said, well, what was your best performance? And God said, my next one, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it entered into your heart what God has in store for those who love him. It's my next one. Make your next move the best move God will make. And now are we children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known, but we know that when Jesus appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Is there a witness here that's glad that the days of yesterday might have been wonderful? The days of yesterday might have been great, but God's got greater in store for you. You're ready to deliver when you know the best is yet to come.
Your life gotta be more focused on crosstalk than it is on payback. You focus on the sacrifice of joy instead of my idea, my way. You're delivering for God when you refuse to let where you are in the world poison who you are, because you remember that whose you are is greater than where you are. That's because God wants to change you, not from the outside in. He wants to change you from the inside out. Once you reprogram, you're ready to deliver for God, because God will bring the best out of your life. The things that have happened in and around your life may not have been the best for you, but God is able to bring the best out of you. Can I borrow my Old Testament brother Joseph before I take my seat for a moment before I get out of here? Joseph, in the book of Genesis, he's tossed into a pit by his brothers and left to try to make it by himself. Stay with me. Joseph, when he sees his brothers, he shows how much of a change agent he is when he says, you thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good. That's a change agent delivering for God right there in the face of insult and hurt, deceit and pain. He could have gotten some get back, but he declares, I ain't programmed like you programmed. You thought evil, but God meant it unto good. I'm not programmed like you. Me being proud of my history and my heritage doesn't make me hate who you are, but it makes me love who you are, because I can only love you if I understand how I love myself. You thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good. I don't know how you read that, but that's a renewed mind, and I got to get out of here. And the word meant in the original Hebrew is where we get our word weave from. Is where we get the word weave from. So the text reads, you thought evil, but God weaved it unto good. Stay with me. Meant is the origin of our word weave. And y'all know what a weave is, don't you? A weave is when you go to the beauty shop and you get hooked up with more than what you would have had you not gone to the beauty shop. Don't look around. Look at me. Don't look around at the weave. Look at me. You got to go to the right person to fix your weave up. The right person can take what they got in their hands and apply it to your situation. And now you got something extra, but based on what you went through, that you had to go through to get it. You took what you had and took it to somebody else that had something extra in their hands just for you. You had to go through some stuff. And now it's yours because of all you went through. Y'all still ain't feeling that yet. And all I'm trying to tell you is that you can deliver for God, because after all you
you've been through. God can weave in grace. God can weave in peace. God will weave in strength. God will weave in power. If you got a new mind, God will give you some extensions on what you already got. Let's get out of here. And I'm glad that over 2,000 years ago, God sent in the right person to work our weave. I'm glad that he sent Jesus to weave in my good. And Jesus took what I had and he applied something new to my situation. And now I got something extra based on what Jesus went through. Is there anybody glad that God worked your weave? Where you taking us, Davidson? He took my sin and weaved in grace. He took my pain and weaved in peace. He took my brokenness and weaved in blessing. And I seem to remember that at Calvary, he weaved in forgiveness. He weaved in hope. He weaved in love. He weaved in power. He died and it looked like a raggedy weave. On Saturday, it looked like we needed a new salon. But my Bible says that early on Sunday morning, Jesus got up because God weaved in the resurrection. Is there anybody here that's glad that he got up? Say yes, yes, yeah. Glad my God is a weave man. He's able to take what I got and able to give me some extension. They become mine. They become mine because God, as God weaved in my salvation at Calvary. At the cross. At the cross. Where I first saw the light. Oh, he was starting to work on my weave and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there at the cross. By faith, I received my sight. And now, I am happy all the day. Stand with me all over God's house. Stand with me. You got a new program in the database. Ears have not heard. God says, greater works, Jesus declared, shall we do? Said, because I'm going to the Father. Jesus rigged the game for us, the game of life. He said, I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm going to send you help to live this life of faith called the Holy Ghost. So what a wonderful God we serve. So you got to decide, you got to choose that you're going to be a change agent. Let us pray. Eternal God, we thank you for the gift of love and life that we found in Jesus Christ. We thank you that you weave in our forgiveness, our good, our love, that you sent Jesus to weave us tightly back into a relationship with you.